on, baby. Do it. There we go.
Since they serve both Los Angeles City and Los Angeles County, to assess their...
Oh, they're not even showing her face.
...to manage and increase funding levels resulting from Measure H. There are failing many service plan areas, particularly Service Plan Area 1, who have homeless families who have been waiting for needed services since November of 2017.
Oh, my God.
They are in need of oversight, and we need to make them accountable. Thank you.
Brian, you got some comments?
Thank you for receiving us. I started out last year at this table addressing that was, in my opinion, was very important to performing our duties. And that issue is that we are not, as budget advocates, we are not in the development stage of the budgets. In order for us to do the jobs that we're being asked to do and provide the information that we are asked, as an example, Councilman Kikorian asked us at the table last year, what departments do we suggest removing? And we can't answer questions of that nature because we're not in on the development stage, so we don't know the details to the degree that we should know. As an example, we have four major departments all providing financial services, and there is no singular guidance to those. We should have a better financial operation that allows for someone to oversee that, just as oversight is necessary to anything. I come from 40 years of being a CFO and in accounting, and practically I am also a graduate of Philmont High School. And we don't have the ability at this point to get to the basics. In ITA, they're trying to finish up the procurement system. Another $2 million on the third go-around. And if you look at that...
Barry, look, what's over there?
Unless we're in the development stages and you can see the details, there are very large numbers in the special services that are not identified.
Let me stop you for a minute.
Get some bill.
Challenges, so if you keep it down, please. So sorry to interrupt.
Thank you. Okay. So, it is imperative for us to do the job that we're charged to do, to get to the details. And we tried this year to contact the budget team, the mayor's budget team, and we were, for all intents and purposes, reviewed. We would like to be embedded in that team. We would like to be able to see what is happening in the beginning, see the details, and be able to make comments on those items. Without that, I think our 1 to 2 hour per meeting with general managers or top people relies on our previous experience in business to bring forth legitimate and qualified opinions. On top of that, we know that the neighborhood councils are a 15-year, going on 16 years now, and they are in sore need of better training. We spend $4 million, or attempt to spend $4 million a year, and I am not sure personally whether everyone on those teams know exactly what they're supposed to be doing and why. I go to a lot of meetings, a lot outside mine. I see what's going on, and I have a very strong opinion that the budget advocates in total agree that there has to be more training. The NCAs have to be trained better and engaged, and the members of the boards have to be trained better to know that their responsibilities, their authorities, and their procedures, so that they can effectively perform their duties. With that, I think I've addressed enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good morning. You know, Brian brought up the point that the transparency and the oversight. We budget advocates are essentially your citizens' oversight committee to the budget. it is a responsibility that we all take very, very seriously. We work with the departments, and we talk with the people, and we find out what's going on, the nitty-gritty of what's going on, not necessarily what you hear from the general managers. With that, a very simple revenue enhancement that I have suggested to several council members, and I have not seen any action on it, where you have the county and the city meeting, there is dumping from the county onto the city because there is only a $5,000 fine if they get caught dumping on the city's property. If they get caught dumping on the county's property, it's $10,000. So why not take a chance and do the $5,000? It's not that much. One of the things that you can do is either have parity with the fee, and that's what, a simple ordinance? That's not, it doesn't take very much, a motion and an ordinance. And it's a revenue generator for the city. My suggestion would be to increase it to $15,000 and let the county take their responsibility. But that's mine. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Pleasure and honor to be here. Spoken a lot about the work of the budget advocates, and indeed, we do put in a lot of time, and when we are very, very serious and committed to seeing that communities' tax dollars are used efficiently, and that departments within the city of Los Angeles strive to work within their budget and the city as well. My contention is very simple, I suppose. In life, it's often the small things that count. And to that, I think that the city likes to try on an ongoing basis to try to find the golden geese that lay the golden eggs. My contention is I think that the city needs to look more under the sofa cushions to see what exactly is available there. I mean, I can't tell you how many sofa cushions I've looked under, how many sparklets bottles I filled up with coins. So there are definitely opportunities there to be pursued. And to that end, such things as bike licensing fees and at point of sale, and thereafter on an annual basis, and to impose requisite fines for noncompliance. Another issue of which, for me, it's somewhat blasphemous, and I might be drummed out of the core, but any given weekend, Saturday, Sunday, and during the week, there are real estate professionals who put out open house signs. And there are laws that prohibit the posting of bills, signs, and other notices on public property. As I say, on public property, which realtors, of course, use to lure people into open houses, as well as notify brokers of them. These laws really have not been enforced as far as the fines. The result is that on any given Sunday, Saturday, sidewalk corners, street medians, and such are jammed with signs each weekend. I would recommend that if unpermitted signs are posted, fines start at $100 and escalate to $500 on the third violation, so at which point it becomes a misdemeanor.
Nazi fascist America, huh?
Real estate professionals can post a sign.
Is how they raise money?
These showrooms, but not at nearby intersections or streets, but must remove them at the conclusion of the open house. I mean, I'm sure you've seen open house signs that linger for weeks and weeks and weeks. And then just to conclude, I'd like to point out that within the city of Burbank and other cities throughout the United States, there are open house permits required anywhere ranging from as little as $10 up to $25 per sign. And if you figure that that's done on an annual basis,
listen to this joker,
for the thousands upon thousands of signs that there are,
can we hear this guy, man?
Los Angeles, that could end up over time be somewhat significant revenue. Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you.
One is regarding the Ethics Commission. We are living in a time when the integrity of the electoral process at the national level is threatened. The city must ensure transparency in the viability of local elections in order for our citizens to have confidence in them and in our government. So I'm hoping that when Ethics comes up, that you'll look at that closely and provide additional funding. Second, this has been a year of many emergencies. There have been fires, Las Vegas, the school shootings even today, the threat of terrorism, and even a nuclear attack, and the inevitability of an earthquake. Here are my questions. Will the city enhance the city alert system and highly publicize how to sign up? Most people don't even know an alert system exists. Will city departments work together to address these concerns? In our white paper, we made suggestions that include studies to possibly revise building codes, varying power lines, mailing announcements in DWP bills to sign up for the little known emergency alerts, working with federal, state, county, and other cities to remove dead trees in close proximity to the city, and enhancing existing emergency management department programs. I think this is essential to the safety of our citizens. Thank you.
Thank you. Jack, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to give a little bit of an overview of some of our thoughts in regards to the budget. And I think the first thing is that we've reviewed this budget quite a bit. Again, we have serious concerns that the budget really isn't balanced. Rather, it's an exercise of trying to hide the fact that the city is engaged in intergenerational theft. The city is dumping billions of dollars of liabilities on the next two generations of Angelenos. The proposed budget does not take into account the raises for the civilian workers, which we've been told will be about $40 million. The budget relies on the transfer of $17 million from the reserve fund. That's a rainy day fund. And when our revenues are up $340 million, seven significant revenues are up over a couple hundred, I don't think that adequate, justifies raising the reserve fund. The budget also relies on taking $85 million from the budget stabilization fund. And when that fund was approved in 2011, the idea was to build a fund, not to divert the revenues to the ordinary daily expenses to maintain our streets, our roads, and our schools. We also have the street damage restoration fee of $62 million. From my perspective, that's just another raid of the Department of Water and Power, because quite frankly, they think they do a better job fixing the streets after they've torn them up than the street services thing. We also talked about raiding the special parking revenue fund again for $32 million. And then we have the issues, Mr. Kerkorian's favorite thing about the city's liabilities. Is $89 million going to be enough, or could even drawing in the unappropriated balance going to be enough? Given that every day you pick up a paper, it seems like we're getting nailed for, you know, millions of dollars for whatever it is. From my perspective, if you look at these expenditures and eliminate the questionable sources of revenues, we've got a budget deficit of more than $200 million. The budget outlook, I think, is cooked. I think it's totally unreliable. Over the next 4 years, we're projecting total deficit of $77 million, including $100 million surplus in the fourth year. But if you factor in the raises to the civilian workers, police, and the firefighters over the next 4 years, the budget gap goes from negative $77 million to over a billion, to $980 million, call it $1 billion, around numbers. And then this budget doesn't take into account the monies that we need to repair our streets and the rest of our infrastructure. That's probably another $200 or $300 million. I know Blue Scott Joe and Mitch have done quite a bit of work on the streets. I think your number was 250 or something like that. And you know, the city hasn't done anything despite having record revenues. It also doesn't include enough money from my perspective with regards to pension plans. And if you look at, you take people like Warren Buffett or Wilshire Associates and some of the people that are pretty knowledgeable of this, they say the pension discount rate ought to be 6%. If that's the case, the deficit goes up to $15 billion, and that would cost the city about another $500 million a year. So I think, you know, when you look at the outlook, you know, we're talking about a shortfall on realistic accounting of over $4 billion. Now, I didn't say, well, you know, you're smoking dope, well, I'd be happy to share the numbers with you. But, you know, so I think that my big pet peeve here is I think we need an Office of Transparency and Accountability. Which you recommended, actually, April of 14, that you thought that was an excellent idea. It hasn't even received a council file. We say that the controller, the CAO, and the CLA are responsible for giving us good numbers. Well, these numbers, from my perspective, are completely faulty. If you were in corporate America, you'd be out of a job and not in jail. So I think we'd like to have a little bit more transparency. We'd like to have monthly meetings. We'd like to set up the Office of Transparency and Accountability. And we'd like to review in detail with you our 10 recommendations that we made this year. But we had many. We tried to narrow it down to 10. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all for all your service. And thank you for coming in to give us your point of view. And Howard, I'll see you around. And Joanne, I need another photo of Sierra, because I'm sure she's over there. I have it right up here on my desk. Anyway, thank you all so very much for your work. So now, with Mr. Corey, did you want to say anything, or can I go into comment, public comment? Or
okay.
All right. So while we start, Mr. Herman, Mr. Previn, Mr. Dan Detmer, please come forward. George, Levy, come forward. Okay, Mr. Previn.